I'd like to call the Board of Commissioners together today on May 10th for our budget hearing. And first up is our fine sheriff, Terry Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to start off just showing a little brief slide. This is reference personnel request for Alamance County Sheriff's Office, and then I'll move on from there. A history of cost of service staffing, of course, our patrol division currently has to cover 435 square miles of Alamance County. And one of the main concerns, our response time to some calls is obviously not critical on some of the calls, but on many of them it is. And we have the, we're supposed to try to prevent injury and help persons in very good, quick time. And we're having a little problem right now. In most extreme cases, the death of an individual can occur before we arrive. And so as sheriff, my duty is to provide protection to these citizens and their property. So that's why I'm asking for more people for the sheriff's office. And I'm asking, y'all. You are the commissioners. But we have four patrol platoons. When fully staffed, a patrol platoon consists of three supervisors, which is lieutenant, sergeant, and corporal, and eight deputies. That's a total of 11 people. But when you take vacation, sickness, school, I have a rule that there's got to be a minimum of seven, or captain or sheriff or somebody has to come out to make that seven, because our county, we have six districts. 435 square miles is a lot of territory to come with that many people as calls come in, as you'll see. Each platoon works a 12-hour shift, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. and 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. However, it is rare that every shift is fully staffed due to a variety of reasons, personal vacancy, like duty assignment, personnel vacancy, like duty assignment, due to injury, or if a deputy is sick or on vacation. So that happens. And very rarely are we staying fully staffed because people are leaving, going with the Highway Patrol or other agencies to pay more money. Good afternoon, Mr. Bird.
Starting late, sir?
That's okay.
He just got started.
Okay, as you see here, we have six districts. District 1, which is the Alamance 87 area. We have District 2, which is the green level area, which they pay for one officer now. We're supplying with an officer and a half there. We have on that District 5, which is Union Ridge. District 3, which is Cedar Rock Park, 49 South, Snow Camp 87, and NC 54 87. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you are getting a call, an officer's tied up, say down here in District 6, or dealing with a serious thing, and another call comes in, sometimes all these other cars are tied up. Officers have to go from the furthest point north to the furthest point south. With blue lights and siren at 75 miles an hour, you're looking at 45 minutes to get across that county. And that is very vital.
Your man is dead by then.
Yes, sir. You're absolutely right. I mean, even then, you're looking at 30, 45 minutes flying, and with no traffic. History and call volumes response time. Depending upon the number of personnel on duty and type of call, multiple officers may be required to respond, thus delaying response to other calls. For instance, Saturday morning, we had every deputy we had out on a call. A guy had beat his wife, almost killed her. She was transferred to Chapel Hill. He was held up in the woods, fired the gun at the deputies. They were calling for help. CCOM had to call me because the lieutenant couldn't even get on his phone. From there, I called our SRT team out and some of the detectives. We responded down there, and after about 2 hours, we had him in custody. But the rest of the county was left unattended, and we had to pull people and send people out from our situation there to answer calls. So we definitely was in need of more officers at that point in time. When the SRT team got there, that was about seven different people. We were able to cut some of the regular uniformed deputies that were patrolling loose to answer calls. Removing routine calls such as speak to an officer, vacation, security checks, and traffic stops from July 1st, 2014 to June 30, 2015, we responded to 28,788 calls. Now, I want you to understand, those were the serious calls we responded to. It wasn't, I need to speak to the officer because my neighbor is raising cane. These were serious calls. From July 1st, 2015, March 31st, 2016, our call volume has already exceeded the number above, as our officer has responded to 31,962 serious calls. That's a lot of calls, folks, for the number of people. Our average response time during both periods is approximately 20 minutes and 31 seconds. In 20 minutes, a whole lot can happen. A home invasion, you know, somebody be killed, etc. In addition to calls for service, so far the fiscal year, deputies served 3,018 warrants. Now, let me tell you, that's time consuming. You're looking at, I'd say, at least an hour to complete the service of the warrant. You take them in custody, you got to bring them to jail. That means you're tied up to jail. Something else happens in your district, somebody has to come across the county to handle the call. Taking far less time, still requiring sworn officers to serve were 336 domestic violence 50B orders during the same period of time. We have to, a lot of times we have to track these people that has committed domestic violence because they dodge you, they won't come to the door. You have to check many times. And if the more routine calls are added, this is all calls to the Sheriff's Department, and our officers are responding to calls and contacts for service as well as self-initiated action at a rate of nearly 72,000 from July 1st, 2014 to March 31st, 2016. Folks, that's a lot of calls because you got to do a report on every single one of these calls. You got to do investigations until detectives come out if it's a serious call.
Well, let me get that.
Sheriff.
Yes, sir.
When someone calls into the Sheriff's Department to request help, there's no way at that time to give us assign a severity to it, right?
You don't know what you've got until you arrive on the scene. We've had calls, hey, somebody's being killed in my backyard, and you wind down, and it's a domestic situation, which somebody could get killed. But we have no way, our dispatchers, and I say our, the county's dispatcher tries to get as much information as possible can out. Is there weapons? What is the severity? You know, et cetera. A lot of times people call, hang up. You don't know what you've got. You've got to get there, help these people. So it's very, very alarming in a lot of ways. According to Bureau of Justice standards, the common practice staffing standard for number of officers per 1,000 population is 2.7. Our service population extracting counties and municipalities is a little over 57,000. Utilizing the above standard, which the Department of Justice says we should have to successfully cover our area and the number of population, Alamance County should have just short of 154 officers. Really? We have 130 sworn officers now, but 8 of those sworn are totally in the schools for school resource officers, which leaves us 122 actually officers that respond to calls or can respond to service, of which 44 are assigned to the patrol division. So that's 11 on a shift, 4 shifts. This is also counting the 8 school resource officers solely assigned to our middle and high schools. That is their primary job, period. Now, I have honestly had some of these officers leave their school when officers hollering for help, leave the school to respond to help that officer keep him from getting hurt. We're requesting 5 additional positions. One deputy will be added to each platoon, which is a total number of 4. The goals of this request are twofold. One, to reduce our average response time and provide more manpower to each shift to help offset staffing shortages. The 5th position will be assigned to our newly reorganized gang unit. We got the Hells Angels here, folks. We've got the Bloods, we've got the Crips, we've got the MS-13s. And as you've seen, Burlington's been catching a heck of a time shooting, you know, being houses shot up. We had a house shot up in Alamance County. Hopefully we're getting ready to make an arrest on that. If granted, we will research the advantages of creating an additional district if we can, or to reduce the sizes of heavy call volume districts, thus creating smaller patrol areas to further reduce response times and determine if minimum staffing per shift can be increased to 8. One person on a shift, and if we were to get 4 more people, I would require 8 people always on a shift, because you'll see in a minute what can happen when you don't have that coverage and officers by himself. Okay, if you could hit this. Now, I'll explain what happened here. Car chasing a suspect. That is one of our deputies, Brad Hall. gets broadsided by a dump truck. This was on, I believe it was the March the 5th. We had a deputy working third shift over in Lamb's Chapel, seen a good job by that officer covering the people are knocked out in the truck. And the officer, of course, shaking up, but because of the airbags and he had his vest on, he didn't have serious injuries other than bruised all over. Now, let me tell you what happened there. It was a situation where an officer seen a dump truck without license at 2 o'clock morning roaming the area in near Lamb's Chapel. He pulled the truck over, approached the truck, two individuals in the truck. One of the individuals had just recently been arrested for trying to kill his mom-in-law out at, I can't think of the name of the trailer park.
Tangle Ridge
Mobile Home Park, which we had to get the SRT to get him in custody. He was a passenger in the truck. When the officer approached the truck, he seen beer, was in their lap, he asked the driver to step out, driver cranked the truck up, took off. Officer started pursuing him. They went up Highway 49, back down 49, out 70, back and into the city. The whole time, the officer was calling for assistance. Our closest officer was probably 25, 30 minutes away from him until they started into the city. And we had a communication problems between the county and city because we were on two different communication systems. The officer runs him into the city. Finally, he pulls over near Beaumont Street and swings out of the dump truck with a pistol and shoots the officer's car all to pieces. Takes off again. The officer could not pursue. Short time later, one of our officers coming, responding to the shooting, picks the truck up, starts chasing. The officer is still hollering for help where the shooting occurred. Everybody's trying to get to him, thinking he was hurt. The car that you seen coming through the light, he got broadsided by the dump truck, was the officer coming to help. When you are chasing at high speeds, you may give a Graves Road in 87, and by the time they broadcast, you already two or three roads ahead of that time. So, and that's exactly what happened there. We're lucky we didn't lose two officers, one in the wreck and one there. So I'm asking the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to look at granting me at least five positions to try to offset some of these problems. I'm afraid we're going to lose an officer. I understand times are bad, and I'll accept whatever the Board of Commissioners or the county manager does, but that's something we need to look at, or I'm afraid I'm going to lose an officer. Any questions on that request? That request would cost us, not counting the benefits, $167,100 for five positions. We would do it with starting position at $33,420 a year is the cost of salary.
Have you done an analysis on, said the average response time was 20 minutes and 31 seconds, I think. Have you done an analysis
of
how much that would improve?
It depends on if we break and add seven districts versus six districts, or we have the lieutenant, sergeant, and corporal most of the time are roving. But a lot of times when a serious call comes out, two or three officers has to go, takes it out. But if we had those, I'm sure it would cut down considerably on the calls. I would prefer let that officer also be roving to get to the areas where we're having high crime. A good example would be Green Level, where a lot of our drug activity, and then near the Burlington city limits, Birch Bridge Road, where we're having a lot of gang activity. We could keep those individuals in those high crime areas that would be able to back the officer up, which would help us tremendously. I don't know, I may not answer your question, but
not
we have looked.
Go ahead, Bob.
Okay, thanks.
Yes,
similar question to that one is, how does that time, the 20-minute response time, compare to other sheriff departments? That'd be one question. And the other question would be, you mentioned this Bureau of Justice standards per population standard, and so we're quite a bit lower than that.
Yes, sir.
I expect that would vary according to area of the country, maybe, or area of the state, here we are with two interstates, that it would have an impact on
the it certainly has, I think, impact on the amount of crime occurring here.
Yeah.
But as far as the 2.7 per thousand, that is a standard Bureau of Justice has set that we need to effectively cover the areas. We have, and I say this, I've been very proud of my people. because they have done an extensive job in getting two calls, even though it's the time is the average for that call with the number of people we have. We have been very lucky, and
I always like to have comparative data, and some of the other comparative data you have, like from other sheriff departments of counties of similar size or that number of population, particularly in North Carolina.
The city of Burlington, to give you an example, the city of Burlington, I think, has 120 sworn personnel for the city of Burlington, and I compared this. Mm-hmm. Their population is probably a little bit less of what the county is. Mm-hmm. However, their sworn people don't. We have a civil division that does nothing but serve civil papers. Burlington don't have to do that. We have different jobs as sheriff. Our courtroom personnel are sworn too, but they don't have access to cars. They drive their own cars and cover the courts. They don't get out of county. If you took all that away and compared it with other agencies, we are way understaffed.
They don't have the geography that you do.
They don't have the geography. And I'll be honest with you, 435 miles, square miles, a lot of territory to cover.
Just try riding.
Hey, and I'm going to tell you something else too. When you holler for help and the closest car is on the other side of the county, there ain't nothing any more pleasant than to hear blue lights and see blue lights and sirens coming. Now, I'm telling you, I've been there.
Sheriff, do you say the Department of Justice says you should have 140?
150.
150.
Not counting the 8 school resource officers, but yeah. You take them out of equation because they're at the schools, 8.
Well, does that 122 include your civil division officers?
It includes every sworn person down the sheriff's.
So you don't have 122 on the road?
No, sir. Do not.
How many do you have on the road?
Well, I can tell you, we have 44 patrol officers. We have about 13 detectives. And then you got five civil, something like that, civil. But, see, they after daytime, they work civil, they serve civil papers, they're gone. Our detective division, they work in the investigations, and they will respond if a officer calls for help or if it's a murder or something like that. But the routine calls, if they're close, they will answer. But technically, we don't have 122, if that's what you're asking.
And I think the city of Burlington has about 50,000 people.
That's about right.
The rest of the county is 100,000 people. Now, you also take care of Green Level, Ossipee, mm-hmm. Swepsonville,
yes, sir.
Alamance,
all the other municipalities.
And so you've got close to 100,000 people you've got to protect.
Well, probably 80 count Mebane.
I would say between 80 and 100,000.
Yeah.
But see, we also, our civil division also has to serve the civil papers in
all
the city.
Yeah.
And we also serve warrants in the city a lot of times.
Sworn deputies?
In do any?
Civil
are. Civil division sworn?
Yeah, they're sworn deputy sheriffs. So that's part of that 122.
Now, you said there's a lot of gang activity in the county or in the cities?
Most of your Bloods, Crips, MS-13, your Bloods and Crips mostly in the city, MS-13, so we got a ton out in the county. Most of them are your major drug traffickers, you realize, and we talked sometime previously about the murders occurring in the county. Some of you had an opportunity to see them. Those were gang, drug-related murders. The Hells Angels has come back to Alamance County and hoping to establish, and you help get them out of here with Dockside Dolls, and they're coming back in right now in big group.
Are they in the county or are they in?
They're in the county.
They're not in the cities?
Ospice Ski Lodge. There's a bar at the edge of Caswell, Rockingham, Alamance County line up 87. And then there's a bar in the city of Burlington that they're hanging out.
Well, I have heard rumors that the Mexican drug cartel is also in Alamance County.
Sinaloa cartel is strong here, Mr. Smith.
So why don't we have more deputies? Why haven't you come to this board for more deputies?
Well,
I understand. But what I'm saying is you come in and you're willing to accept whatever we approve, one, five, A good friend of mine was here not long ago and said that the city of Burlington had 8 more patrolmen than you do, and you've got a lot more territory to patrol.
True.
So well, what do you really need? How many do you really need to protect the people in Alamance County? You also have jurisdiction in the city of Burlington.
Yes, sir.
Have been there any
well, I'll tell you what, if I could get 5.
No, it's not what I'm asking.
Okay.
100, 150?
Well, no, I'll do that 150. I guarantee we run the crime out of it. 10. But
no, 10.
I'm telling you, our people are very dedicated, Mr. Smith, probably more so than the average department. If I could get 5, we can do a lot of things here. But to do what really needs done, you're looking at probably 15 people. And I just don't think the county, you know, I don't know if the county can afford that. However, if our county manager and the board want to give them to me, I assure you, I would work the daylights out of
them. It seems to me, though, that there should be a strategic plan put in place that the board or whomever decides in conjunction with you, the number of officers that you really need to do the job like you're supposed to and everything compared to other counties, and then not do this thing like a faucet where you drip, you get 5 and 3 and 1, and determine how many you need and put a plan in place and just assume every year he's going to get X number of officers what I have to do this.
Well, I would certainly love
that idea too.
And do it on a systematic.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's just understood. That's what I am.
I would love to do that, but I know, to the commissioners for, you know, for several years we were having to take furloughs, and the county was in bad financial shape, and believe me, we needed them then. But I'm a conservative in a way. However, I have to agree with Commissioner Smith. We need to do something about it, and maybe I've waited too long to come for the board to ask, but I've did a lot inside the agency, and for instance, y'all aware of the captain I had to get rid of. I took her position. She was making so much money, I was able to give me 2 deputies, starting position, you know, starting deputies, with her money for 1 salary,
right,
which helped some. And that actually allowed us to put 11 people on a shift.
Well, in my opinion, and I think this is, government was always set up, the number one priority is protection.
I agree.
Not schools, everybody thinks it's schools, but it is not, it's protection. And if we don't have enough deputies out here to protect the public, then we're not doing our job. We're not doing government's job.
I agree.
So I agree with Roger that, you know, you need to set up some kind of strategic plan and get this county to where we don't keep having Mexican drug cartel and all of these gangs coming in here, and those people we rent out when they were running Dockside Dials. That was fun, though, I'll have to say.
That was a little excitement.
Well, this is something that we could incorporate in the strategic planning that's being developed now that we're all planning to meet. I don't think it's been scheduled yet, but we could make this a priority.
As part of the overall county goal in that particular area.
I'll be honest with you, I intended to next year to ask for 5 more.
Well,
I don't know where I'll get them, but I'm going to ask.
That's what I was alluding to. The county's not going to get smaller.
No, your
job is not
the population is growing tremendously.
It's grow,
and it's a lot of it is the population that we really don't need here that's causing the problems.
I mean, the ultimate goal would be to do away with law enforcement because everybody would be doing the right thing, right?
That would be a wonderful world, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's the personnel request, and I'm through with that. I'd like to go on down. 4310, which is the sheriff's side. I have 3 budgets. I have the sheriff, I have the SRO, and I have the jail. On the sheriff's side still, I'm asking for an increase of $45,628.50 for small tools and equipment. The reason, we need to replenish our CSI supplies. That's crime scene investigation. There's all kinds of materials that we use, and I had been buying it out of federal drug seized monies. Well, we don't have any now. And they say we're getting the checks in the mail, but the check's been in the mail for the last 2 months. These items are necessary in order to photograph, collect, preserve, and test evidence found at a crime scene. This is a must in criminal investigation, and the evidence collected can be the determining factor of a jury's guilty or innocence in a criminal case. And we have enough problems now with the courts bringing people in, giving them life sentence, and we catch them the next week doing the same thing. And we have got to strengthen our ability to collect and preserve and present this evidence in our courts. So that's another request, which would increase that line item 241 to $220,000 a year from $174,371.50. 4310, 321, telephone and postage. We're asking for an increase there of $20,000. You're saying, well, why that much? Raises, increases due to more employees and need more cell phones by investigation division, increasing the number of cellular devices, and also in our in-car computers and various things, we have to have computers in our cars and everything. We're adding more people. We got to have computers in those cars and the hookups now, for the computers.
You don't have body cameras, do you? Or?
No, sir. And okay. Look at me. As long as I'm sheriff, I'll resign before I put a body camera on an officer simply because it does not show the true picture.
Well, I heard
it
that.
It does not. Now, if they would give body cameras to mount on guns, I would do it because if you pull a gun and shoot, it's going to have what's going on there. But just like the Greensboro incident, I'm sure y'all seen on the media. They raised and came back to body camera now, and of course the investigation done, they chose not to charge the officer, but all the picture isn't always shown on the body camera. Now, in-car cameras, right. If you chase an individual and you in front of that, yes, sir, I support that. Okay, maintenance and repair vehicles, which is 4310, 353. I'm asking to increase from $143,000 to $150,000, $7,000 increase. Four more positions since I'm breaking positions up in the office, you know, by cabinet stuff. I've been able to salvage four positions, has been added to the agent, and we must provide vehicles, which has to be serviced during the year. Each vehicle will travel approximately 25,000 miles annually. These vehicles issued will not be new vehicles, which will require more maintenance because we don't have money for the, we're having to use vehicles to give the officers that we hire. And if we get one more, five more, whatever, we're going to have to supply those needs for that officer. 4310-540 capital outlay vehicles. And I will say, County Manager and Mr. Smith, y'all both said a few years back we needed to start adding 12 vehicles every year, rotate them in and out, and that had been working wonderful. But at $30,416.67 a piece, and that's what we look like we can get them for now, you're looking at $365,004. So that is a capital outlay issue. That will buy 12 vehicles and help us equip with sirens, blue lights, etc.
And you retire 12 when you buy 12?
Yes, sir. What we normally do, and we're looking at something different right now, but that's going to depend on Randy downstairs. When we pull those vehicles off, if they still got some miles, I want you to understand, a police car who may have 100,000 miles on it actually is about equivalent to 300,000 miles on other cars. But we turn our better cars over to the county if they use the social services, etc. And if not, they have been sold on Gov deal, but the guy we're dealing with now on the new cars, he got a contract. He said, heck, I'll buy them cars and give you a whole lot more money than you can get on Gov deal for them. So we're talking to Randy about doing that now, which will save us money. However, I still want to look after our department heads in the other departments that needs vehicles. If we got better vehicles they can use, I'd rather for it to go to them if they want. School resource officer budget stays the same. We have eight officers that work school resource. Now, our retention budget, 432019 professional services. It in the current budget this year is $156,612. But due to the exceeding cost of Central Prison in Raleigh, there are several we that are so bad or get so sick we have to send to Central Prison because we cannot hold them here. These are gangbangers, these are murderers and people like that. We're And Raleigh, an additional $100,000 is needed in housing serious medical inmates, and these are extremely dangerous towards staff. Now, Mr. Bird, if we can get this mental health stuff off the ground in this county, that is going to be reduced tremendously, believe me. And that's something I'm looking forward to hope that we can get done here in Alamance County, is intake facility for mental health issues that should not be locked up.
Right. What is it costing you now?
What is the mental, right now, our health is over $1 million. This is just the holding, feeding the inmates at Central Prison Charter. When we get to the medical, you're going to see the increase. But right now, we're over $1 million for health, sickness, et cetera. And a lot of it is mental health issues. Okay. Also, in addition, we need $17,200, and this is because we have started a GED program at the Alamance County Jail. We partner with Alamance Community College. They come in, inmates that want to get their GED can get it at the jail, and I think we've had two or three now that will be graduating, that has passed. These are individuals that want something better in life, and they're willing to come in and take the courses and then take our state testing, and hopefully, if they get that GED, somebody on the outside will feel better about giving them a job, and they won't be returning back into our facility. And so far, it's been successful. And we have to pay a person $25 an hour to stay with the instructor that teaches. We have materials that have to be used, etc. So we're asking for $17,200 to do that. We do, I think, two a year is what we're looking at trying to do. Okay, 432351, asking for an increase of $20,000. This is maintenance and repair of grounds and buildings. Last year, this item was cut $20,000 by and leaving $40,000. Currently, we have only $3,300 left with things to do. We currently have floor problems in the detention center. We're currently painting the detention center. And let me say this, inmates are painting that detention center. We're having to buy a lot of paint out. We have to replace and restart plumbing materials because they're always tearing something up in the jail, the inmates are, and we are looking to switching all of our lights to LED lighting for cost-saving steps. We will initially buying the LED bulbs cost more, but in the long run, we will save a whole lot more money because they last longer than the regular lighting, and we're looking at that. And be cheaper on the power bills. 432440, this is the medical. We now currently $934,734 is our current budgeted amount. We need to add $180,708 is needed to cover overages consistently incurred in regards to the inmate health care system. Here's another one. Mental health is part of this problem, and believe me, it is a major part of the problem because we have 40% of our inmates, and I'm counting drug use, addiction in that 40%. 17% is severe mental incapabilities, and this was done in a study by UNCG in Greensboro of our detention center. So these figures are, according to them, are accurate figures. Also, $55,000 of that will go to Southern Health Partners to employ an LPN rather than a med tech. They got somebody that pay $10 an hour, and I'm telling you, we need an LPN to oversee our drugs and drug cabinet and distribution of drugs. Are we headed for a problem?
Can an LPN do that, or RN?
Well, the RN oversees, but she goes around, checks all, makes sure the medication is given. The RN checks, and we have a guard that has to go around with them when they're dispensing the medication also. And our risk pool this year is going to be going over. We're going to have to put more money to it. Now, here's the bright thing. 432441, contracted services food. We currently were given $660,000. And I said, I'm asking, and I told our county manager wanted, I'm asking for an additional $60,000, but if we keep the population down what it is, I won't need that $60,000. However, I have been smooching to Marshall, trying to get more federal inmates into the jail to be able to offset the cost of the operation of that jail. And certainly, he's looking in and doing what he can possibly for us. But probably, if we don't get any more Marshall prisoners, we won't need an additional $60,000. Well, but you cannot judge that population. From time to time, it'll go from 340 to 420, then back down, but you still got to feed them.
So the marshals are not using your jail now?
No, we keep about 50 marshals, but I like to do that. Like we used to, about 110, 115. We got room for them.
Cost, right?
So what's built in, what's the assumption built into the revenue budget for those kinds of inmates?
Okay, well, all the money, and see, I don't have a record here in front of me, but we're holding state misdemeanors, which come from other counties and get paid $40 a day. Marshals pay 67 something. All that money goes back into, and Susan may could tell you the amount of revenue per year. I know at one time we were bringing in, we held ICE inmates about $6.2 million every year. And I think now you're probably looking close to $2 million. I may be wrong.
With the misdemeanor as well as just regular jail fees, we're looking at 1.6 for next year.
Million coming in.
Do you know what the volume assumption is? Like how many average daily census does that represent?
We get those figures from the Sheriff's Department, but we can get that information for you.
Because you'd have to have some kind of a assumption to build your revenue budget. I mean, we just need to make sure that the revenue and the expenses match up. They're using the same assumption on both sides.
Well, I think, you know, we are, and I shouldn't say this, but we're probably making money versus what we're spending along those lines. Matter of fact, I know we are. Now, I won't say it's a ton, but, you know.
Of course. Federal,
and the good thing is, Mr. Bird, where we had 100 inmates in there, where we holding 300, we still have to have the same staffing.
No, but the food cost was.
Oh, yeah, food cost.
That was the line item that we were looking at.
Right. Okay, 43-25-20 capital outlay computer equipment. Folks, we have had four different camera systems in our detention center. Some parts are not, companies are not in business right now. I am asking for $208,500 to put a whole new camera system through the entire detention center and sheriff's office. Now you say, well, why do you need that? Well, like I said, currently we have four different systems. They are outdated, parts cannot be found to fix them, and companies have gone out of business on some of them. The detention center, not counting the prison annex, holds 396 inmates. It is imperative that the camera system be updated to give officers the availability to receive and record the actions of all inmates and staff. When issues occur, the taping of all activities can vindicate staff from any wrongdoing, and a recording camera can be the difference between a lawsuit and no lawsuit to the county. And I'm telling you, we have had situations like where Clyde is. He can tell you, we had camera videos that saved us from what inmates were saying this. We had one the other day, and I just tell you, said he fell and hurt his back. He's in here for murder. Well, the camera caught him stuffing towels and stuff in his pants, and then he falls, you know, and he didn't know the camera was there. Then he pulls his towel on them, and he said, oh, my back. Everybody's seen him fall, but nobody's seen what he'd done, but the camera did. Things like that happens in that jail.
Smart people, smart crooks.
They got 24/7 to think about what they can do.
They have a lot of time to think, not about good things, but things.
And I know that's a lot, folks, and I just ask you consider what you can. I will abide by whatever your decisions are, but we need everything we've asked for. And more, Mr. Smith.
I told you not to call him.
Mr. Hankins.
He said to have him escorted out after his time was up.
Mr. Hankins.
Folks, come over to the Alamance County Sheriff's Office, ride with a car, or go through the jail. You have. I see what goes on. You have. We built that new jail.
So. I haven't done the car yet.
Do it now.
I haven't done the car yet.
We've taken the jail tour a few times.
You really need to. But I'm telling you, when you have to go from one side of the county to another in a hurry, I assure you,
that's worn out car. That's what he's gonna put you in.
You don't even wanna ride with him. Going to lunch, I'm done.
Any questions? Please, if you have any questions, ask.
Good job.
Thank y'all very much.
Thanks, Sheriff.
Thanks, sir.
All right, next is Debbie with Emergency Management.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'd like to introduce myself first because I haven't met everybody individually, but I'm Debbie Hatfield. I'm the new Emergency Management Coordinator here in the county. And this is my first budget to present, and as you see, it's not a lot that we're asking for that's changed from last year. There's just been a minor increase, and we do have one capital item, which is a vehicle for me, in, for my position.
Page 43, yeah.
It's 4330.
Yeah, 43.
Emergency management.
Well, that was way too simple.
It was. I guess because I'm new, it made it easy on me.
I'm glad she wasn't back here making notes off the sheriff's presentation, right?
He's a hard guy to follow. So is there any questions for me?
I'm good. Anybody else have a question, Debbie, on that? It's very simple, and we're glad to have you with us.
Thank you.
Debbie will also make a presentation at our next board meeting to discuss tornado preparedness.
Hurricane.
I'm sorry.
Hurricane preparedness.
Very good.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. Moving right along then. Fire Marshal John.
I am in charge of three budgets. Got the fire service, the SARA management planner, and also the fire marshal. I would like to cover these in that order, please. 4342 is the fire service. There's just a couple minor increases. One of them is departmental supplies and materials, 4342-260. We increased that by $100 for ladder testing equipment for stickers. We'd test all the ladders out in the county for all the fire department, saving them a substantial amount of money where they don't have to go outside and hire somebody else, so eventually saving taxpayers money with that. Down on 4342-440 contractor services, we are covering the radios and pagers and the tower maintenance for Alamance County, the emergency services, the Commonwealth, an increase of $136 on that for radio maintenance contract. Any questions on that one? All right, the SARA management planner, that budget is 4345. It has stayed the same. No increase on anything on that. One thing they have asked to do, they have $150,000 they would like to build a building for us. We have equipment, our MC1, our mobile command unit, is sitting at the jail annex down here. It is fenced in, but it is not covered completely. It's weathered on the front already. We've got a decon unit that sits down on 54 at Station 1. We've got a command trailer that's out in Neum Holt District, out in Station 9, inside one of their buildings. We've got our absorbent vehicle in the chiller building at the old hospital. We've got a generator out Station 2, which we deploy at in case of any hurricanes or tornadoes, anything to that effect. We've got equipment inside of a building at Burlington Fire Department Training Grounds. And LAPC had a big major contribution. They bought a lot of this equipment for the county. They would like to see it under one roof where we could go to one site and respond at it one building instead of responding all over the county. So they do have $150,000 set aside to purchase a building for that. 4340 is our fire marshal budget. Professional services, we went up $150 for physicals for our fire inspectors. We doubled our uniform budget, $400 to $800. And our dues and subscriptions went up $100 for any National Fire Protection Association dues increase from $2,500 to $2,600. We are asking for one fire inspector. Back in 1988, we had four fire inspectors. We've done, latest records I could find, we'll go back to 2000. We've done 749 fire inspections that year. And last year, we've done a little over 1,300, so we almost doubled. Whenever David Leonard retired as fire marshal, we just decided, the county decided to split the departments up. We have emergency management coordinator, which you just met, Ms. Hatfield, and eventually took away one of our fire inspectors. We're down to three and trying to still cover all these fire inspectors. We are asking for a fire inspector to be added back as a employee. And also capital outlay, budgeted, like to have an increase or not increase, a budget for $20,000 for fencing for the building if we get it built to protect and security for the building. The LAPC is willing to buy to have all of our equipment under one roof. Do not know where the building will be. It all depends on where we may end up with the facility study. We don't want to build a building that's not too far away from us, so if we're going to stay over close to where we're at on Martin Street, we would hopefully build it somewhere in that area. So, any questions?
So you're looking to buy the land and build a building?
Well, we're looking to basically find some county land.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have some property.
So we're checking out some property.
There's some property over off of Martin Street.
Right beside us is the wooden,
The
pine thicket, and also the helipad back on behind the.
How big a building, square footage?
60 by 80, I'm sorry.
60 by 80.
Yes, sir, with four bay doors, and we'll get everything we got into one roof.
Okay.
So I have a question, two questions. One is, I don't understand by the separating of the fire marshals function from the emergency management function, how we ended up with one less inspector.
If you look, when Dave Leonard was fire marshal / emergency management coordinator, it got too much for one person to do. And we were not doing really the job we needed to do with respect to emergency management. And so we felt like that needed to become a full-time.
I see. So you replaced the fire inspector position with the.
Right. And when we hired Debbie, we have not created any new positions.
Right. So you're making it neutral.
She's changing titles.
Gotcha. All right. I understand. And then when I look at the salaries, though, that's in the budget, what's being requested compared to the 15-16 budget, it's less. So is that.
Part of Debbie's is separated now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
And Dave Leonard's salary.
All right.
Yes, sir.
I guess. All right. Thank you.
I don't have any more questions. Does anybody else have any questions? Thank you very much, John.
Thank you, John.
Okey dokey.
Right.
And next up, I guess, is Mr. Haygood, EMS.
Yes, that's why I got it.
You got a new department title head and all that, right?
No, I'm taking the liberty to present the EMS's budget. I don't know if all of you folks have met Billy Jenkins. Billy is our interim director of the EMS department. He's been doing a fantastic job the past several months running the department. I asked him if he would mind if I presented his budget. We've done a lot of work at county management level and HR and finance to put this together. Billy's been very busy running the department, doing an excellent job. So he knows the service much more than I do, so he's here to answer any particular questions that you have. So I'll go over the budget with you. At this time, the department number is 4370 if you're looking for it in your book. When you look at the salary part of the budget, it shows a 4.9% increase. We have a few things that we're requesting this year. One is to establish a career ladder for the employees of the EMS department. We're asking for $24,000. That would create a way that employees can move up without actually becoming into new positions. We would create eight field training officer slots and 12 base captain slots that would be certain qualifications employees could go after, try to get, and then qualify for these spots. We're also asking to, in the salary area, reclassify our four assistant crew chiefs. EMS has four crew chiefs and four assistant crew chiefs. These crew chiefs are not official positions with county government, but they carry a lot of responsibility. They act as a crew chief in the event the crew chief is off or not working. So we're asking to reclassify them. That cost would be $7,916. We're also asking to reclassify the training officer position. That cost would be $6,660. And we are asking for that because the main ask in the salary line is for a new position, an operations officer. This would be a full-time position. The salary would be, the proposed salary is $69,570. This would be a second in command at EMS. We feel that would be very important to have a line of succession. We also are looking at this position to take on some more responsibilities locally of billing. If you folks will remember here, a number of months ago, we had some real issues with billing. And one of our desires is to give people a better outlet to be able to come to local EMS. You know, our bills are going to Paducah, Kentucky, because that's where our company is located. But we heard loud and clear, people want to be able to come here, Crescent Square Drive, talk to somebody live, handle their bills, or we believe this position would also help with that among numerous other duties. I want to touch briefly also on the capital requests. In the capital line items, we're asking for two Striker power stretchers. These total $120,000. These are the power stretchers that pick people up. The paramedic can put the patient on the stretcher. It's powerized. It lifts the person up and then power motors them into the ambulance. We have a few of these already. Our goal would be to eventually have all power Striker stretchers. These do save our paramedics' injuries, which, talking with our occupational health nurse, EMS is one of our top workers' comp claim groups with the Sheriff's Department, and a lot of those injuries are related to lifting patients. So this is a preventative, hopefully, to help keep our paramedics healthy. We're also requesting $190,000 for the two remounts for two ambulances. We remount these ambulances about every 180,000 miles, which is about every 4 to 5 years. So we rotate these out. We're having a couple done this year. We'd like to be able to get two more. This keeps them running, extends their life. And the new capital request, because those two were in this year's budget, the new capital request that we're asking for is $166,956 for fiscal year 16-17. This is to replace 24 LifePak 15 cardio monitors. EMS uses these monitors on board each ambulance and all the quick response vehicles. They are one of the paramedics' number one tools that they use when they get out to a call to hook you up to see how your heart's beating, what's going on with you. The ones we have are LifePak 12s. They are between 8 to 10 years old, depending on the unit. This is an expensive replacement. The total cost to replace 24 of these is $643,661. We're proposing to do that over a four-year period. So this $166,956 would be once a year for 4 years. But that would replace all 24 at one time. So every ambulance and every quick response vehicle is outfitted immediately with them. You don't have some vehicles with LifePak 12, some with 15. All of them are the same. So that way, if a crew gets on one vehicle, it's always the same cardio monitor. And then I'll go ahead and move into the operations side. That's capital and salaries. Just briefly about the operations, the middle part of the budget, you'll see a 20.3% increase in medical and scientific supplies. That's $38,000 due to increased drug costs and the fact that EMS is required to have new and different and more drugs on each vehicle and on the shelf in our storage area. So as drug costs continue to go up, we're going to see that line go up. You'll also notice an 82.5% increase for training. That sounds like a lot of money. That is $6,600. $2,000 of it is for a course at UNC for 10 employees. It's a Mayday trauma course. We'd like to be able to send employees from EMS to be able to do some continuing ed there. And $4,600 of that cost is for training certification cards. When these folks go get recertified in all the areas there, they have to have like four core certifications plus their recredentials. We require that they carry training cards that indicate that they've had that training. We require they demonstrate that to the training officer to prove that they had it. Those are the costs for those training cards. You'll also see an increase of 42.9% for maintenance and repair of equipment. That is for radio repair for EMS. The EMS budget also pays for the rescue department's radio repair. That is $1,500. And then you'll notice one of the largest increases, 280.2%, is for contract services. What's going on there is the maintenance cost for the new cardio monitors. But that figure is not correct. I'm afraid I gave finance a wrong figure for that. We will recalculate it, but it was not the $100,000+ that I told them it would be. I don't have it today. I think it's going to be closer to $50,000, $60,000, but so you can disregard that, but it will be an increase. And finally, the last increase you can see on their budget, 33.3%. That is a $500 increase to dues and subscriptions. That's in hopes if we are able to fund the operations officer, we would be able to affiliate that person with their professional organizations that EMS has. So, at this time, I'd be happy to try to answer any questions about EMS service, and I'm sure Billy would be able to help me too. So,
have you got enough people to drive any new units you get upfitted or whatever? I know one time we had vehicles, but we didn't have people to put in them.
Well, I'm glad to report, as of today, we are at full capacity. Okay. We have all slots full. We are looking at one person, I believe, that will be leaving in the not too distant future, but we're at full, so that's very good news.
And all certified and all that sort of?
Yes, sir. They're either paramedic or intermediate or basics, but for the most part, we have a lot of paramedics, and that's what we'd like to have, as many paramedics on trucks as possible.
Still 7 trucks, 24/7?
8 trucks.
8 trucks, 24/7?
Yes, sir.
Don't you need another one?
We need another one.
No, I'm serious.
He's
10 years ago, the hospital wanted us to have 12.
Yeah.
So. Well, the county does continue to grow, and we're working right now looking at the times that we are out of trucks. I think so far this year, in 15-16, we've been out of trucks just from middle of February to the 1st of April, total time, almost 30 hours. So that means for those 49 days, we've been out of trucks, I mean no truck available to send on a call for about 30 hours. Now that's a concern. We never want to be out of trucks. You can't have a truck for every single event, but we're looking at some ways to address that. That might include new vehicles, but also could include how we staff. But I have to tell you that the folks at EMS, we've spent a lot of time working with Billy and his folks, extremely dedicated people, and very, very responsive. So,
are you rotating your trucks?
Yes, sir.
How many new ones do you get a year now?
Trying to get two new cabs in the chassis, rather. Get two of those, and the box itself gets refurbished every couple of years.
Yeah. We did two this year, looking at two next year.
Are there comparative standards in the EMS industry, like the performance standard that you just mentioned, how many hours that we don't have service?
Yes.
And or things like average response time, or how many trucks per population served, or things like that?
Yes, and we've been working with the medical director, Dr. Qualley, to try to figure out how best to calculate our unit hour utilization. I think that's one of the big stats that we're trying to look at is, you know, how many hours is that truck available? How many hours is it used? What are those hours? We don't have any comparisons at this time, I hope. Now, I'll be talking to y'all at the next meeting, next county commissioner meeting, about the ICMA software, the Insight software, that hopefully we'll be able to do some of these comparisons. We don't have that right now, but they are out there.
We may find that we're really under capacity or understaffed, and we might need to have another strategic plan like we were talking about with the sheriff to get up to where we need to be once we look at that kind of data.
Yes.
Anybody else? All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right. We're going to take a quick 10-minute break and come back. We'll have Mr. Mac Williams speak to us.
He's here.
I'm Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance Chamber of Commerce. Delighted to be here this afternoon to go over the request, which hopefully you've already received on paper in your materials there. The county, along with the municipalities of Burlington and Mebane and Graham and Elon, and also the village of Alamance, contribute to, and when I say contribute, I want to go back to about that word in a moment, but I'll use it for the purpose of starting the conversation. Contribute to a public-private partnership that is funding our economic development programming. On the county side, along with the other cities, you're really providing a fee for a service. It's not really just a contribution to a nonprofit. We are proposing that we provide a service back to you, and that service is the promotion of Alamance County, the handling of economic development clients, and the successful handling of which results in their either location of a new facility here or the expansion of an existing facility and the creation of new jobs and new tax base, which in turn is a net gain back to the county. So our services are to provide that function on behalf of the county, the cities, and the private sector investors who have contributed money through the Alamance County Economic Development Foundation. Our request to the county this year is for $125,000, which just gets back to the level that the county was funding the chamber in this public-private partnership 10 years ago. There were a few years where that level was maintained, and then that level got dropped back along with all others who, for one reason or another, were reduced, and we're slowly trying to get that number back up, just back to where it was 10 years ago when all these other partners signed on and who have maintained their level of contribution throughout the period. So this is a multi-partner relationship here, and that's the request of the county from a number standpoint. Just in terms of what we're delivering back, you have as part of your material a report that we generate. It looks like this. It's the report of company announcements that have occurred in Alamance County since January of 2012. In the fall of 2011, we did a major fundraising campaign on the private sector side, and the private sector stepped up for a five-year period and pledged $1.7 million to go toward this partnership over this five-year period. And in advance of that fundraising, or as part of that fundraising, we set goals for the five-year period to follow. So after some considered effort and a look at the 5 years previous, we determined that we thought we would be doing well in the economy. And remember, in 2011, having no idea where the economy was going to go or what was going to be going on, we thought we would stretch ourselves and try to seek projects that would result in a total of $250 million in capital investment in the county and 1,500 direct jobs. There's no 1.6 multiplier jobs that would result if one manufacturing job, none of that stuff. It's just all the company announcing direct jobs. And what you have here is a report year by year of the companies that have made an announcement in Rockingham, in Alamance County, since that time. And actually, I don't know that we've added now Honda Aero this year, and I don't think we've added what is going to be the Alamance Foods project either. So neither of those are all in here, added in here. And I've noted on there, while the chamber would love to take credit for every single bit of that, obviously there are some projects that occurred without our assistance or influence or involvement. But where we were instrumental and where we were engaged and where we had material value to add to the process, we have put an asterisk by that so that you can see where we actually were materially involved. But at the end of the day, you can see the numbers, and that's the total numbers, not just the ones we were part of, but the total numbers have added up to a significant surpassing of both investment and jobs over those 5 years based on the investments and jobs that the companies announced, which is what our typical measures are for measuring how we're doing. So we think we're in addition to working with projects, new and expanding industry projects, a couple of other things that we are doing in our economic development program. One is developing product. And about, when I say product, what I mean is working with the public and or the private sector or both to create sites and buildings. In this day and age, these are things that you really, it's hard to wait on. You try to get sites and buildings somewhat farther along, so that risk and time are taken out of the process by the site location process. In some instances, the private sector has stepped up and done some things. In other cases, the public sector is stepping up and doing some things. In some cases, it's a joint effort to try to get sites and buildings either ready or more ready than they are now. And that is the case with, for example, the North Carolina Commerce Park between Mebane and Graham. A lot of work has been done on the public side to bring roads and water and sewer systems into that roughly 1,000-acre area over there for the benefit of serving those two clients, Walmart and Lidl. But in addition, all of those same investments are now able to serve a much broader area where we can go out and now sell product that we didn't have before. So that's a net gain to us. Same thing with over in the Mebane area. There's an industrial park over there that was already in existence, but now we've done some work with public and private partnerships to bring rail into that northern part of that park and open ourselves up for some opportunities that heretofore we didn't have perhaps an opportunity to try to recruit. So these kinds of things are product development initiatives that we try to, and they aren't quick and easy, but if you stay with it long enough and work with people and be partners with people, these kind of things can eventually come to pass, and we're in a better shape having product in place or product more in place than it was before our efforts were engaged. And the other thing I would add in terms of our activity, we have since in 2015 we created another position. Up until 2015, there was just myself and one other person doing the economic development work. We added another position that's completely funded by the private sector side to service our existing industry people here. And already an example of that kind of assistance is we had the DOT engineer from the Greensboro office come and meet with a group of companies in the Mebane Industrial Park, NCIC and Mebane, who are going to be impacted by the construction of NC-119 bypass. That is now funded. It's going to happen. They're going to start at the interchange with Interstate 85 and 40 and redo that interchange and work their way north toward and over US 70 and extend on up to NC-119 about where Mill Creek, the entrance to Mill Creek is. That project is bumping around now for a long time, but it's finally in place, funded, and will be coming forward. And so our staff generated a meeting for all the folks who wanted to attend that are in that park to come and ask questions, have input on the timing and the phasing of perhaps how that project would unfold. So those are the kind of things that we're hoping to uncover and work with and help existing industry with their needs. And that's a new addition to the staff. So we're slowly and broadly extending what we can try to do to add value to our manufacturer base that's here. That's my comments. Everything has been written and provided in writing. That's my oral summary, if you will, to reemphasize and confirm the things that are on the written application. I'd be happy to provide more information or answer questions.
Yeah. What's the estimated time of completion for that 119 thing going out to Mill Creek? You know,
the I believe construction is to start in 2017. Right away has now been acquired, at least from the, as I understand it, from the interstate up to about 70. It may be acquired beyond that, but I know that right-of-way has been acquired up to and perhaps through 70.
Yeah, I see a lot of stakes in the ground.
That's right.
Both sides of the roads.
All those survey stakes, that's what you've seen is the survey stakes to define that right of way.
But do you, in your position, do you foresee the 119 thing having a positive impact on Kate's Farm as far as anything going out there?
I know there have been some residential developments proposed for that area. Certainly any access back to the industrial park from Mill Creek and other residential areas enhances that live, work, play concept of living and working near those things being near each other. And so it can be an asset in that regard to the extent that it helps that it helps or hurts a specific development. I don't know that I could tell you, although I do know it's going to help the industrial part. Beyond that, I don't know that I could tell you what the impact would
be. Well, is part of your job, do you advertise Alamance County? I mean, like send out flyers or?
Not in a typical advertising with ads in magazines kind of thing, yeah. Although.
You know, like if you're on an airplane, you read through the magazine and say,
we don't have,
may have been or whatever.
We don't run ads like that. What we do try to do is, when we have an announcement of some kind, we have a database of site selection consultants, utility people, real estate brokerage people that we send out an e-newsletter to. And we send that out on a somewhat regular basis when there's a new announcement, or if there's a new program, or if there's something new significant like NC 119. The other thing we try to do is to try to have our deeds speak for us. And in recent weeks, we've had two magazine, statewide and national magazine articles talking about our program and things we're doing in Alamance County in those articles. So they weren't ads, they were better, they were content, mm-hmm. they were articles. But we don't do anything on a regular ad basis like what you're talking about.
But you do get inquiries.
Oh, wow, we get inquiries all the time.
Web-based inquiries that come through them.
Yeah.
Well, you're on the website.
Yeah, we get lots of inquiries. And this is a situation where very few of our clients actually come to us directly. The circumstances now are such that most users will, not everyone, but more and more clients will go through a third party. There'll be a site selection consultant. They'll come through the state of North Carolina, they'll come through a real estate brokerage firm, and they'll be anonymous for a while, certainly initially, and they'll just be anonymous for a while because they want to do things in anonymity while they're trying to figure out what, if anything, they're going to do. And they don't want to upset people back home if they're going to close down. They don't want to get people overly excited for no good reason if they're just looking around but not going to come there. So they look around in anonymity for a while and they use these third parties, and we usually communicate with the third party until there comes a point where we have to interact directly with the company official for purposes of a performance agreement for an incentive or whatever reason. So
an amendment's got a Chick-fil-A syndrome. Every time you see a backhoe or something sold on the corner lot,
they want a Chick-fil-A.
Get on Facebook, send Chick-fil-A.
Can you send that ad out back to help? We need to get.
And we really don't work with commercial and retail inquiries. They don't come to us. Usually, commercial and retail projects. The incentive is the community. If the metrics and the demographics of a community don't work for a certain kind of retailer, there's no incentive we can offer that'll make it work.
Yeah.
But if the community does meet the demographics and there's a market for who they are and what they sell there, then the community is the incentive. Then the question becomes, okay, which corner do we go to? And they employ brokers and they just bypass us altogether in that regard. We very rarely are engaged with developers or end users that are in the commercial retail space. Our work is almost exclusively in the manufacturing, warehouse distribution, back office, call center kind of operational facility that a company might be trying to consider, or an expansion of a local similar type company like Alamance Foods or Honda Aero. that's who our customer is.
I will mention that the chamber just did the rebranding, and under that coat, Mac has some pretty big guns.
That's why I didn't bring anything. No pictures.
Thank you, sir.
What's happened with Southern City? Have they started construction?
They're in the building. They're operating.
They are?
Yes, sir.
Do they have a restaurant like they do in Chapel Hill in Raleigh?
Not in the Mebane facility. That's strictly a warehouse distribution facility. Okay. What they're doing in these other places is that retail, restaurant, cooking school kind of place that you've seen in Chapel Hill. That's what they're trying to replicate, as I understand it, in more markets around the southeast. I don't know if one of those will come to Alamance or not. Again, I don't know if the demographics are here for that. That's for them to decide. But in expanding all of those retail, restaurant, cooking school kinds of facilities in other places around the southeast, they needed a bigger spot to store more stuff and distribute more effectively to those places where they're expanding, and that's why they came and opened up a place here in Mebane. That's strictly warehouse distribution.
Well, do you kind of keep in touch with the Highway Commission, whomever? For example, once they do get these two distribution things online over there in Mebane, the Walmart and the Lidl, I see it where they are building roads out of the complex.
Yes.
But I don't see anything happening out there on the highway.
Well, they did put in the lighted interchange at that new road and Trollingwood Road. They reoriented the driveway to the mobile home park across the street. They had to build a new driveway into that mobile home park to so that the intersection would line up. Yeah. They've done turn lanes at the interchange, but you're right, from the new interchange back to the interstate, and from the new interchange back to NC-119, it does narrow back down to the two-lane road over there.
But if they don't do something, and you dump several hundred trucks a day on that thing, that's going to be a negative toward Alamance. I mean, it's going to be negative for a while because people around here will not care for that at all.
Well, and plus, there's going to be a new truck stop on the other side.
Right.
in addition to. So, you know, road improvements these days are driven by numbers. And DOT will do assessments and traffic, and they'll do predictive models. And then you've got this whole new system for rating. New roads, certainly, or improved roads, and to some extent, road work always follows the demand, and sadly, it's way behind the curve.
And that's 2 years from now, if they find the trucks way out the road, you're going to
very, very little. I don't think very often you'll find DOT getting out ahead of with expensive construction projects to get funding road work on spec.
Yeah. Mm. Thanks, sir.
It's usually demand driven. So,
any more questions, anybody? Thank you, Matt.
Well, thank you for your consideration. Let me know if I can provide any additional information. Thank you for your time.
All right, very good.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, sir. All right, next up, we got Mr. Mark Danley from Cooperative Extension.
Good afternoon.
Howdy.
So our number is 4950. And you'll see that under the salaries and wages, we have a 1.7% increase, and that's to fill our vacant family consumer science position. So this is a foods and nutrition position. So this will be half-time shared with Guilford County. The funding will be one-third Alamance, one-third Guilford, and one-third from the state. So primarily focused on foods and nutrition, providing training for the Serve Safe program, which all the restaurants are required to have now. We'll do nutrition classes for health department. We're partnering with Healthy Alamance now with this new North Park Farmers Market, which is going very well, trying to provide fresh fruits and vegetables to underserved communities. And part of the challenge there is teaching people how to cook squash and eggplant and things like that if you don't have experience with that, so you actually would eat it. So it doesn't do much good to have fresh fruits and vegetables if people don't buy it and don't eat it. So we're trying to do that. Then, you know, food safety questions we have all the time. You know, people will
had the freezer go out and the food thaws out, and they want to know how long they can keep it and cook it and eat it without getting sick. So we're trying to answer those questions, you know, with the increased interest in local foods. We have lots of questions now about food preservation. So trying to do canning and freezing classes so people, if they've got a big garden, they know how to preserve this stuff for later on. Probably will provide cooking classes for 4-H groups. Eat smart, move more, weigh less with the health department. So lots of things just revolving around foods and nutrition. But we have had some reductions in our operating expenditures. Actually, our total budget is about 2.3% less than what it was last year, even with this little bit of increase for this FCS position.
How long has that been empty, Mark?
Been vacant for 3 years. So Jessica left in 2013. We shared her with Orange County. Yeah. They already had a full-time person. So when she left, they still had a full-time person and weren't interested in sharing again. So we had to wait until Guilford County had an opening so we had somebody to share with. Their person retiring, I think, this month. And so hopefully if you approve our budget, then come 1st of July, then we'll fill this shared position with Guilford County.
Okay.
Are we actually
have we got a commitment from Guilford County for on that yet?
Yes.
We do?
Yes.
Okay. You think they could send us an email in writing that they're committed to that?
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Okay. Yes.
I think that's a big holdup. That's what I was talking to Susan about, is making sure we had that commitment.
Right.
Well, I know that there's a lot of activity going on in this community to support local foods and part of the agribusiness. Yeah, I know I sit on the food collaborative. I expect this person would be on the food collaborative.
Yes.
Part of Healthy Alamance.
Right.
And I've gotten a couple of calls about how important this position is.
I think we get a lot of calls.
You have support.
That's right. And as it is now, so our support people are taking these calls and doing the best they can to answer these questions. But still, it's nice to have somebody who has a degree in nutrition and can really answer these questions knowledgeably.
And are we going to be able to get 50% of this person with Guilford?
We'll have 20 hours here and 20 hours there. So.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll be sure of that. We'll get our time.
Very good. All right. Is that
it? Questions?
Any more questions?
Okay.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
All right. Soil conservation. Brad Moore. There he is. I didn't see you. Hiding behind the sheriff.
Good afternoon. For those who do not know me, my name is Brad Moore. I'm the District Conservation Administrator for the Soil and Water Conservation District. We have a fairly small budget. We do have a few increases this year. Under the operating expenditures, I did add a line item of educational supplies of $1,000. We do many education things now, basically through partnerships. When Mac was talking from the chamber, I was thinking about the three things we partner with the chamber with: leadership to Alamance, an ag banquet, and farm to table, where we do about 800 fourth graders at Cedar Rock Park, and we solicit funds from the community, the ag community, and many businesses to perform that. But in addition to those things, there are many other things that we could be providing education on. I found some data a while back that there's over 2,500 farm ponds in this county. Many of those ponds are 50, 60 plus years old. Many of those ponds are in repair. Many people have owned ponds, inherit ponds, and end up with ponds that don't know much about how to maintain ponds. Many of these ponds were built for irrigation and flood control at different times. But there is some management that we could provide, or some education that we could provide them. There's other types of field days we could provide farmers, do some things with, I don't know if many of you know that, you know, pollinators are in a decline right now, whether it be some material for school children, material for teachers, things of that nature. Also like to have some small cover crop plots at the ag building. So when you're talking about it, you can go out. So we'll come outside and let's just look at it, show people something. that nature, and some root boxes and things of, it's easy to talk about some things, but it's a whole, you can save a lot of words if you can show them, and the picture goes off in their mind. One of the other things was an increase was our conference and trainings and expenditures and so forth. And basically that was an increase of $397, and that was to send two employees. We have a total of four employees, but send two employees to some annual training this particular year. It is held in Asheville. The past several years we have not attended. It is a rotating training that's in different regions, and we haven't participated in the past several years basically because we haven't had the funding, and that's where we get a lot of our training for our jobs. Maintenance and repairs, it's an increase of 56%. I thought that was near at first because I only added $336. So we have a total, as you can see, of $600 to maintain three vehicles. That $336 increase is to purchase two tires.
How old are the vehicles?
We have a 2004 Chevrolet truck with about 75,000 miles that was purchased with grant money outside of the county, however the county maintains. We have a 2005 old sheriff's deputy car, as the sheriff's mentioned before. It's actually in pretty good shape. It's got 135,000 miles. We're just missing a lot of paint, but it runs pretty good. And we have a 2007 Ford Expedition with around 37,000 miles that was also purchased with grant money or outside funding that obviously the county maintains. Outside of the Expedition with 37,000 miles, the fleet's just getting older, and as you know, it just takes more money to maintain older vehicles, so that's why the increase. And the last little increase was for an additional $60 in dues and subscriptions, just reflect the actual cost of our area dues.
We were frugal, ain't we?
Very good, Brad. Brad, yeah, they do a lot of work with our school children. I've seen some of these folks out showing about soil conservation and stuff, and that's important today. Kids don't understand that, especially in some of our city schools. They don't know what you're talking about, so it's hands-on, and they do demonstrations, do a really good job with that, and also working with our conservation across the county with our farms.
So you work with 4-H's too, don't you?
We assist 4-H. Cooperative Extension actually houses the 4-H person, and we do have one day in the summer. It's called, they have many day programs or day camps, and it's called 4-H Fishing Fun. We take them down to Cedar Rock Park. We talk about pond safety. Most kids think ponds are natural. They don't know they're man-made. We talk a little bit about aquatic life. We talk a little bit about safety as far as life preservers. We have a neat little demonstration. We put ice in a bucket and put pennies on the bottom of the bucket, and it's a game for the kids. You time to see how many you can get out, and after probably 25 or seconds or so, their hands don't function properly, but it shows them the effects of hypothermia and how if they fell out of the water or in the water so forth, how it affect them in swimming back to shore.
Right.
My grandson's over there right now.
Playing disc golf.
Yes.
Well, Brad, thank you for all y'all do over there and helping out with the conservation across our county.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Library, Miss MJ Wilkerson. She's got her staff with her today. They're going to back
do.
You up.
I have MJ. My moral support, my two associate directors with me. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about the budget. We did not ask for any additional staff this year. There's a need, but we'll hold off on that until next year. And I'm going to jump down to the capital outlay, and then I'll talk about the operating expenditures. Last year, we had asked for an additional line item in our capital outlay to purchase a new van. because our van was in such bad shape. And so that was year before last. And then last year we added a line item for grants to handle the purchase of a lot of computer and equipments through grants. And we just needed a line item to cycle that through. This year I have asked for an increase in the line item for books, because that was cut my first year here 6 years ago. It was cut by over $100,000, and I'm trying to slowly work my way back up to 200, to where it was at 200,000. The cost of books has increased, but that budget is not quite keeping up. I've kept the AV line item the same, but I have asked for an increase in the electronic materials. A typical database subscription will run anywhere from $6,000 to $10,000. Electronic books for library, the e-books that are so popular out there, for a library to purchase an e-book, the rate, the cost is sometimes 70% more than it is for you or me as an individual. And then after 23 checkouts, we have to repurchase it depending on what the publisher is. So that's a big cost for us. So I've asked for a slight increase in the electronic materials. So our books and materials that we check out come out of our capital outlay. So our capital outlay is a little bit different from other uses of it. Our operating expenditures, some increases from the library supplies, and that's just because the cost of supplies is going up. The microforms we kept the same. Leased audio visuals we increased because we were in the hole by $800 this year, so I had to adjust for the increased cost in that. Periodicals, again, the cost of magazines and subscriptions continues to rise, so we need the funds to cover that. And that includes e-magazines. So when we subscribe, part of the platform for that comes out of our contracted services, but the actual subscription to the magazine comes out of the periodicals line item, 235. So that's why the jump that you see there from 17,000 to 21,000, and then this year to the request for 23,000. The lease plan is something that we've always had, where we leased especially the most popular titles. We dropped that plan last year because we used money from the Friends to pay that. So we didn't put it in our budget. And the Friends, we used the Friends money for something called a Lucky Day collection, which is the high demand items. They have their own short checkout, higher fines. But we still used some of the lease plans for our regular collection. So we wanted to find a balance back of that. So I've added that line item request back in there for leased books. That's to kind of explain that. So the year that 50 Shades of Grey was the popular title, we had 100 people on a wait list for that. So we try to have so many copies per 10 people in line. But we don't want to have to spend all of our money on one title, you know. So we lease it, and that way we can send it back. The automotive supplies and the maintenance and repair of vehicles, we've asked for an increase because we're looking at outreach services, and we have we kept our old van when we bought the new one, and we are looking at possible bookmobile services or ways to reach out and into the community and take information and books out to the community to have a presence at the festivals. And so we have several possibilities that I will be bringing to you at a later date, but one of those is possibly upfitting the old van. So that's why the increase is there. The biggest increase, well, there's a couple of increases I wanted to highlight. In communications, which is 329, I believe. There's something called E-rate, and that has saved the county in this past year $10,000. And it's for it's sort of an equalizer for counties to have access to internet and telephone services. And it really is a great savings for counties, for libraries and educational systems. That's going away. And they're phasing it out over the course of the next 3 years. So as they slowly phase it out, I'm trying to add that money in to cover it. It's never been guaranteed that we would get it, so I always had to pretend that I wasn't going to get it and ask for that request in case I didn't. But we anticipate, if we don't get it, an increase in need there. So that's why the increase in the communications line item.
When you say you mean we're being charged less because we're...
We get a discount or a break. The library does. I don't know about the rest of the county, but the library does because we're an educational system. Schools.
This is from Time Warner?
It's any internet or phone service that school systems use. It's very complicated. I don't even understand. I just know that we have to sign away our firstborn child and know that we go to jail if we violate it in some way, shape, or form. And a lot of library systems just have their own, they hire an outside company to fill out the forms and handle the E-rate applications and things like this. We only use E-rate for our telephones because of the way our internet is set up through, it's different for each library, or it was. We're working on making it more consistent. I don't even understand all of the E-rate, but I know it's been a huge savings to us.
If it's Time Warner, they don't understand it.
Exactly. But I know it's something that was set up for educational institutions like this public schools and public libraries. I've asked for an increase in conference training. We have been hesitant to send staff away to some training, but this year we were able to send them to computers in libraries, to PLA, and we're already instituting some of the ideas that they brought back from that. We're digitizing some of our local history stuff using public source software, and we just use Periscope to stream Active City Streets live. So, and these were ideas that were brought back from some of these conferences. So we feel very strongly about being able to have continuing education for our staff. And under contracted services, that's a big jump. We last year subscribed to something called Collection HQ, which is an international company that comes into libraries, to public libraries, and looks at their collection and what's getting checked out and what's getting checked out at what branch, and saying they'll take all the statistics and analyze them and say, this book or this collection of books is just sitting on the shelves at May, and we think that it would circulate if you moved it to Mebane. And so it's a way to make a more effective use of our collection by putting it where it's going to be used, or getting rid of it if it's not going to be used anywhere. And it will also identify where our collection needs to be beefed up. So if it's old or out of date, it will save staff a huge amount of time by making our collection more cost efficient and our staff more efficient in what they do.
Do you advertise with other libraries, around the country, that, hey, we've got a collection that's...
We do participate.
They do the same thing with you.
All the libraries, both public and academic, have a service called Interlibrary Loan. So we are constantly shipping books back and forth to each other. And in fact, this year we have a collection of book club kits that we have collected that we will be sending throughout the state, which is part of why the increase in postage, because we have all these book club kits sitting in our basement, and so we're putting word out to the rest of the public libraries in the state that we have these available, and they'll check them out through Interlibrary Loan. So there is a way that all the libraries throughout the country know what the holdings for each of the branches, libraries, and share. But that the maintenance service for that is one of our biggest contracted service expenses, and the rental for our smart boards and our copiers, our lease plan for our copiers for the public and for staff are our big maintenance contracts under the 440 line item. That's pretty much most of the, I mean, other than just the general increase in the cost of supplies and materials, those are the kind of the highlights of what our big expenses are. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them.
I think we're good. You must have, you did a great job.
Thank
there,
you.
Andy. All right, last up for the day is Brian Baker, Recreation.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I think this is the second year in a row they've put me last, but I'm not going to read anything into that.
Saving the best for last, is that it, Brian?
Guess look on the bright side. Well, I'm happy to report, first of all, that we've had record attendance this year at the Parks Department. We're our highest number of people ever. We serve about 500,000 people a year, and that's things are looking good for the Parks Department. We're just getting more people coming, and our satisfaction ratings are staying level, so that's good news. And that sounds like a lead into I'm asking for a bunch more money, but I'm not. our budget's actually showing a net decrease this year. We have some line items going up, some going down, so I'll just kind of address some of those with you. The two largest increases are a $10,000 increase in our small tools code. That's something we've discussed at a recent board meeting, but that's essentially a $10,000 insurance policy for us. We have experienced a fair amount of vandalism and theft on a routine basis over the years, and our insurance policy doesn't cover small losses like that. The county's insurance policy doesn't. So this is an amount of money that we're going to set aside. We won't spend it unless we have a break-in or a vandalism issue, something like that. And if we do, that'll be a small insurance policy for us. But if we don't, then we'll be happy to return that back to the general fund. The second largest increase we have is in our contracted services code, and that's for increasing the amount of trout that we put in the pond at Cedar Rock Park. This is a project.
Alamance County has trout.
Pilot project that we started this winter to see if it would work. We had $2,000. We found somewhere else to try it out, and it's gone better than we expected. We're selling fishing licenses, and we've actually made a profit this year on that program. So I don't know if that'll continue forever. I'm not making any promises there, but we're doubling the amount of fish that we're putting in. So to accommodate that increased demand. Our capital expenditures, we are requesting a new truck to replace a 1992 Ford Ranger that we have, as well as a mower for Cedar Rock Park to replace a 1998 model that we have, and as well as a new backhoe attachment for our tractor, which we use a lot, and that's a 1984 model, and it's all done. So our capital budget for the year has gone down compared to last year, but just routine replacements we need to make. And those are the highlights.
It's hard to argue with a budget. It's down everywhere you go. I mean,
it won't be every year, but I'm happy to do it this year.
Yeah. A lot of traffic out in these parks. I know, Roger, you're just kind of coming on board, but I'm on that committee, and Brian does his report every meeting, and shows all the attendance, and our parks are so well attended. It's kind of hard to wrap your mind around that.
He came in and presented last week, and I can't remember how many thousands of people a year, but it was mind-blowing.
Yeah, we're 500,000 people a year, and the number surprises
me too.
To
hear a number like that.
It is amazing, isn't it? Yeah.
My grandson's over there right now.
It's Cedar Rock. They're all at Cedar Rock today. I pretty routinely have them go check our counters. We have counters at our facility, and I have them go check. Like, there's no way that many people came last month, but they do. They're all
there. Brian does a great job with that. So.
Is there any movement on a northern park, Brian and Brian? In the past, we've tried to get people to donate a park or something up there.
So there's no large park increases that we're looking at in the northern part of the county. There are a few parcels that we're hoping to acquire.
Benko is about the only one in the north that we have.
Well, no, about 5 years ago we opened Shallow Ford Natural Area. So
that's huge.
It's 200 acres.
We have Pleasant Grove.
Pleasant Grove is in the north, the community center. Glencoe is about 30 acres, and Shallow Ford is about 200.
So Shallow Ford is 200?
Mm-hmm. That's a nice trail.
Yeah, those are our largest facilities in the north, and we're always growing, trying to continue to grow the Hall River Trail to connect those parks, and that's moving along.
I've got a grandson that caught a fish last summer, so he is fired up. If I took him to Cedar Rock to go fishing, does he have to have a state fishing license, or can he get a day permit?
Both. So he'll need a state fishing license, and that's from the state. We don't do that. We have a $5 per day fishing fee for Cedar Rock Park, or you can do a 25-year annual pass. We sell those there.
So because it's a public facility, you have to have a fishing license.
You do. We're not in the state license enforcement business, but those guys come around time to time. So yes.
Yeah, I want to
take
you
out there.
But you
may catch a trout when you go out there.
That'd be good. My granddaughter, his sister's, she's into it too. So yeah, that'd be
there
fun.
There you go. Excellent. Find out when he's stocking it.
Yeah, I have some secret information on when the fish comes.
Oh, good. I give you a call.
Brian, thank you very much.
Thanks,
well, I guess with that, we'll wrap.
Let me ask MJ a question. MJ, is there any movement on the Elon Library?
We were just actually talking about that on the way here. We were recently asked about how many of our patrons are from Elon, but as far as I know, there is still no movement on that. When I first came here 6 years ago, I had gone to talk to Mayor Tolley about that, but that was when the economy crashed, and he just felt like that was not the time to pursue it, and has not expressed an interest in renewing that.
Well,
but there's still a need.
I think in the past, Gibsonville was involved or wanted to be involved with it.
I know the mayor asked me a number of times, would we help?
Yes, Gibsonville's a funny little library because it's not part of Guilford County. They pay some towards supporting it, but it's really a municipal library that's supported by the town of Gibsonville, and they were very interested in us in sort of coming into our system and being a part of the Alamance County Public Libraries. They would have to move so that they're in Alamance County, and one of their members had found a building that was on the Alamance County side. I don't know what their plans are right now. I was on the interview committee that helped them hire their new librarian, and she's just done some phenomenal things with that little library. I would love to eventually take them in under as part of our system, because there is still such a need for a library in the western part of the town.
There.
But
yeah.
they are in Alamance County now?
They are not.
They are not.
Just over the line.
Okay. Of course, that line's in question.
just make the line just like
right
around the
right
library and we'll be good. So, yeah, but and I know they're looking at moving the library, and I don't know if they're going to make it as part of their new welcome center, convention center that they're working on, or actually move it into another building.
Okay. Any further questions? Anyway, thank everybody for doing such a fine job today and bringing your information. And
tomorrow, same bat time.
We'll be back again tomorrow, 1:30. Thank you.